Hello, everyone, and welcome to our September 3rd Thursday webinar. My name is Bethany Christensen, and I'll be introducing our speaker for today. Dr. Kevin Sherman has been with us for a few years. He's from our Lewiston, Maine office of Septitech. He is an expert in all things water and wastewater with 30 years of experience in the field. And today he'll be talking to us about something a little bit different, something that he and I agreed would be very interesting for our viewers, something that they may not know much about, namely constructed wetland systems. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Dr. Sherman to teach us about this very interesting topic.
Thank you, Bethany. And welcome to the presentation, Constructed Wetland Systems. And as Bethany told you, my name's Kevin Sherman, and I work for Septitech out of Lewiston, Maine, as the Director of Engineering and Regulatory Affairs. On the last slide of my presentation, we'll give you two ways to reach me if you wish to discuss any of the information I will be sharing with you today. I'm a licensed professional engineer in 17 states listed at the bottom of this slide. If you are accessing this presentation from any of the states listed on this slide, you are hearing the voice of a licensed professional engineer. However, if you are accessing this presentation from a state not listed on this slide, or a Canadian province, or really anywhere else in the world for that matter, you're hearing the voice of a knowledgeable layperson. I would like to begin the presentation with an outline of the topics I intend to address. So the presentation will begin by naming and describing the system components and briefly explaining the operational process of constructed wetland systems. If you are hearing the term operational process for the first time, what it really means is this is what it is and this is what it does. Next, I will highlight the advantages and drawbacks of the system. I will then discuss what site conditions are particularly well suited to constructed wetland systems. There have been many constructed wetland systems installed throughout North America. I will describe some of these to you as case studies in the next step in the outline. Finally, I'll provide the estimated cost for purchase and installation and discuss how easy it is to maintain this class of systems. If you have any questions at the end of the presentation, please do be sure to type them into chat when you see them, so that I can address them to you via email. Any suggestions for improvement would also be very much appreciated. Okay. So what kinds of water are constructed wetlands able to treat? They really are very, very versatile. And the types of water they can treat include agricultural runoff, industrial wastewater, municipal wastewater, stormwater runoff, landfill leachate, and even mining wastewater. Climate has an enormous impact on the choice of a constructed wetland versus another treatment option. In colder climates, concerns for freezing and plant die-off limit the usefulness of constructed wetlands to just during the growing season. So as a small aside, what is wastewater really? It's probably not the right name for it. There are no wastes in wastewater. What is in wastewater are really resources that are out of place. All of these resources would be beneficial to growing plants, however. Constructed wetlands places these resources in the reach of growing plants. So the water, very helpful to them, organic matter, nitrogen and phosphorus are very key nutrients for the growth of plants. So constructed wetlands is one of the options we have to place those resources in a place where they can be used beneficially. This photo is a impacted stretch of river in the Canadian Rockies. And I'll just use the pointer here to point out these are constructed wetlands over here. Oops, sorry, back up. Over here and over here that have been planted in this stretch of a surface water for improvement. So basically they're taking the river water, sending it off into a byway, and in that byway they're putting a lot of wetland plants in there to basically improve that water quality. So the hallmarks of a wetland are shown in this photograph. They are the terms natural and the term passive. Those are two big important aspects of constructed wetlands. So constructed wetland systems are known to be aesthetically pleasing, but they're not designed to be pleasing to the eye. They're designed to treat polluted water. They're constructed in shallow ponds or channels using primarily native aquatic vegetation. The plants themselves then rely on natural microbial, biological, physical, and chemical processes to reduce contaminants in water to acceptable levels. Plant photosynthesis releases oxygen as a byproduct of the chemical reaction. Oxygen escapes from both the leaves and roots of plants to their surroundings. The oxygen released by roots is important to aerobically treat these polluted wastewaters. Look at the two photographs on this slide. They show two very different ways of creating constructed wetland. The photograph on the right, the plants are surrounded by water. The photograph on the left, the plants are installed in gravel and a free water surface is not visible. Both of these examples are constructed wetlands, but it shows that there are basically two ways of creating a constructed wetland. Specifically to wastewater, constructed wetlands are built with uniform depths and regular shapes. Constructed wetlands should be sited close to the wastewater source to save on the conveyance costs. Constructed treatment wetlands can and often are placed in areas that never contained wetlands originally. The wastewater added to the site will allow the wetland ecosystem to thrive. When wetlands are used for additional benefits, such as wildlife habitat, for research, recreational, or educational uses, they're called enhancement wetlands. And you'll see in the case studies that both constructed treatment wetlands and enhancement wetlands are been readily used around the country. So the components of a constructed wetland are a watertight and structurally sound septic tank, a treatment cell or multiple cells, and plants. A single treatment cell would be the minimum acceptable in a constructed wetland. Treatment cells can be either lined or unlined with a free water surface or with vegetation as shown in this artistic rendering where the plants themselves are rooted into a gravel and the water level is set by the elevation of this outlet device. See if I can. Okay, here it comes. That elevation right there is going to set the elevation of water in this thing to just underneath the ground surface. So in some areas with deep water tables and well-drained soils, and that's sort of what this slide is showing, a second unlined cell can be substituted for the soil absorption field that's shown in this slide. So you basically have one constructed wetland running into another constructed wetland. And in that process, the second one would be unlined and the effluent would basically drain into the soil in that situation. Alternatively, a synthetic polyethylene liner or impervious clay liner can be used in place of that. Note the presence of flow controls at the entrance and the exit of the wetland cell. the water level. So here it is. This is actually a 3D and it's looking at you. So that pipe goes from one end of the wetland to the other in cross section, and shown here in cross section, and another similar pipe down there at the other end. And the water level in the wetland is carefully adjusted to benefit the plants throughout the year. So during a dry period, that water level would be rather high. During a very wet period, that level might be a little lower, just to keep the plants in the optimal growing condition. So the operation of a vegetative submerged bed, which is what this is illustrated on this slide. Note the roots are what are submerged in the pea gravel medium. The height of the adjustable standpipe controls liquid level in the aggregate. As shown here, saturated soil will be found from the base of the cell to within an inch or so below the surface of the pea gravel. Also note the inlet T extends the width of the wetland cell, and the pipe is extended toward and away from us, will be perforated, as will be the collection pipe at the other end. The bed has a slight, here a 1% slope towards the outlet. Effluent should slowly travel laterally from the inlet side to the outlet side of the cell with no short circuiting. The prime directive is to keep the plants healthy. You may learn of hardier species for your area over time. You can plant a trial plant in a constructed wetland to see how it does over time. Depending upon the location, they need to be thinned out over the summer. Now, this technology is capable of taking septic tank effluent, which is basically primary treatment, a BOD of say 140 and a TSS of approximately 100, and treating it down to secondary or better treatment levels, which would be about 30-30 for BOD and TSS. There are two types of constructed wetland, and this one is showing the second type in detail. So the second type of constructed wetland uses species that are commonly found in natural wetlands. Typical vegetation consists of cattails, reeds, sedges, and rushes. The water level is observable in these systems. So there is a free water surface throughout the year in these systems. The aquatic plants are rooted in a layer of small diameter rounded gravel with a larger amount of soil mixed in, because it's actually being used not just to hold the plants in, but also to allow the water to basically move between these upward facing plants and basically create a gauntlet that the water has to go through before it gets from the inlet side to the effluent side. The leaves and roots of the plants prevent short circuiting of the effluent flow. Note the outlet height is adjustable to keep the free water surface visible in both wetter and drier than normal conditions. And that is shown over here to the right. See here, there it is. So that elevation is going to set the elevation over here behind it. So this keeps the vegetation in optimal working condition throughout the year. So this drawing highlights the difference between the two types of wetlands that were mentioned in this presentation. In a submerged flow system, the wastewater is treated as it flows laterally through the porous medium, and there's no free water surface. A vegetative submerged bed is shown here in the field, and you can see sort of a before and after picture. The one thing you can count on a farmer doing is growing things. And in this case, over 2 years' time, the vegetated submerged bed is full of lush vegetation. So you can see a lot more evapotranspiration is going on, and a lot more growth of the vegetation itself is happening. So additional maintenance issues may come up as the constructed wetland ages. A key consideration is is ensuring there is no short-circuiting in the effluent flow. If the effluent arrives too quickly at the outlet, it will have an unacceptable level of BOD and TSS remaining. Pests and insects can be controlled by burning the surface vegetation sometime during the winter. These wetlands may attract burrowing animals. You'll want to discourage them before they succeed in ruining the liner containment. So there's lots of maintenance that goes into it, but it's pretty self-evident and easy to take care of. You don't need particularly esoteric machinery to do this, basically. Furrows, hose, shovels, et cetera, is all that's needed. So there are advantages and drawbacks to the constructed wetland system based on its operational process. So let's get into those issues now. The advantages and drawbacks of constructed wetlands are detailed on this slide. Sometimes an advantage or drawback applies to just one of the two types of constructed wetlands available. Advantages are in the left-hand column. Disadvantages or drawbacks are in the right column. Freezing, concerns with mosquitoes, keeping unsupervised visitors away, and UV disinfection by sunlight are all attributes of the free water surface wetland. Both constructed wetland types require lots of land, are aesthetically pleasing, robust, and are inexpensive to construct and operate by hardworking but less trained individuals, but neither of them is a good fit for treating high-strength wastewaters or on very small lots. So where do constructed wetlands make the most sense? What scenarios are suboptimal for constructed wetlands? Individual constructed wetland systems are not suitable for a 1,000 lot subdivision, for example. Systems can be operated with pumps and electronic controls, but the use of passive alternatives appear to better respect the vibe of these kinds of systems. Look for low density occupancy areas where land can be inexpensively purchased. There seems to be less and less of such places still available in the United States, but where they do occur, a constructed wetland should be considered there. Here are some general guiding on sizing for constructed wetlands serving single family residences. Oxygen is provided through the roots of the plants, but oxygen transfer efficiency is not as high with constructed wetlands as it is, for instance, in suspended growth aerobic treatment units, for instance. A three-bedroom home with an estimated sewage flow of, say, about 450 gallons per day, and also having about 300 milligrams of BOD plus TSS concentrations combined, would convert to a mass loading of 0.4 pounds. Removal of 0.4 pounds of BOD TSS would require about 400 square feet of a constructed wetland to achieve. For an idea on what 400 square feet of constructed wetlands would look like, this vegetative submerged bed wetland is approximately 10 foot wide by 40 foot long. Note the very green grass associated to the of the constructed wetland. This is basically the area where capillary pull is pulling the moisture and the nutrients into that grass adjacent to the wetlands. So for the next part of the presentation, I would like to briefly discuss six case studies of constructed wetland systems projects in the United States. The case studies span a wide range of climates, site conditions, and what the purpose for the constructed wetlands was. In no discernible order, we'll get into it. The first one is a case study from Hillsboro, Oregon. The Jackson Bottom Wetland Preserve was begun in 1979. The site is a natural bottomland. In 1989, the Jackson Bottom Steering Committee broadened its efforts from just improving the area wildlife habitat and passive recreation opportunities to include improving the water quality of the nearby Tualatin River bordering the preserve. They chose to develop Jackson Bottom experimental wetland at this site. Discharge from the nearby secondary wastewater treatment plant is run through a part of the wetlands. The treatment constructed wetland takes up 15.4 acres of the 635 acre wetland site. Its purpose primarily is reduction of nitrogen and phosphorus coming from the wastewater treatment plant's effluent. The photograph at the bottom of this slide is an education center on site in the preserve. The next case study is the Orlando Easterly Wetlands Reclamation Project that occurred in Orlando, Florida. It's fairly large in scope. The Iron Bridge Water Pollution Control Facility in Orlando, Florida produces about 200 million gallons of effluent per day. This effluent achieves the highest treatment level standard available in Florida rules, called Advanced Waste Treatment, or AWT. AWT effluent cannot exceed a monthly average of 5 milligrams per liter of biochemical oxygen demand, 5 milligrams per liter of total suspended solids, 3 milligrams per liter of total nitrogen, and 1 milligram per liter of total phosphorus, and also non-detectable fecal coliform bacteria concentrations. Despite this extensive treatment, Lake Harney, the next water body following the Iron Bridge Water Pollution Controls Facility along the St. John's Rivers, continued to experience deteriorating water quality and algal blooms. The project wound up restoring 1,220 acres of altered grazing land back to its natural wetland state. The results of the project were so promising that the Florida Department of Environmental Protection recently lowered the discharge standards to 2.31 milligrams per liter of total nitrogen and 0.2 milligrams per liter of total phosphorus for this project. So it's doing much better than just advanced waste treatment with the addition of the constructed wetlands. Another measure of the success of the project is how the flora and fauna have responded to the reclamation efforts. I have personally been to this site, and it is impressive. The upper left hand photo and moving clockwise, we start with an anhinga, also called the snake bird, drying its feathers in the sun, followed by a shot of one of the deep water cells near sunset. Next, below that, an alligator, and finally, a tourist accessing one of the many walking trails in the area. Note the last two shots were very distant from each other. The next case study is in Wadsworth, Illinois. It uses constructed wetlands to cleanse river water. The Des Plaines River runs through southern Wisconsin and through Illinois. The project is located 35 miles north of the city of Chicago. The main concern here is high turbidity levels in the river water. The constructed wetland is nearly 2 miles away from the river itself. River water is pumped to the highest elevations of the constructed wetland cells and flows gradually back to the river under gravity. Wetland vegetation responded favorably to this new hydrology. The wildlife in the area, including two bird species endangered in Illinois, are thriving under these new conditions. Another case study comes from Arcata, California. This seaside community of 15,000 is about 280 miles north of San Francisco. An existing facultative lagoon was struggling to keep up with the growing population in the area. The city wanted to decommission the lagoon and install a new upgraded wastewater treatment plant. The citizens had other ideas. They wound up in the end adding 7.5 acres of constructed treatment wetlands, followed by 31 acres of enhancement treatment wetlands to polish the effluent and get rid of primarily excessive nitrogen and phosphorus in that effluent. A similar story on a smaller scale describes a small community of Fort Deposit, Alabama. The community of 1,500 100 is located just south of Montgomery, Alabama, the state capital. The community had to modify their 10-acre waste stabilization pond to meet revised, stricter discharge permit standards back in 1985. The solution they came up with was a system that was an 8.9-acre aerated pond flowing into dual 7.5-acre free water constructed wetlands run in parallel, and a 75,000-gallon post-treatment aeration prior to the discharge. Dissolved oxygen was the main parameter that needed to be controlled by this improvement in their wastewater. Two of the above case studies I already gave you were discussed in the textbook Small and Decentralized Wastewater Management Systems by Ron Kreitz and George Tabaniglis back in 1998. Note that both projects used 7.5-acre constructed treatment wetlands. The Alabama project, however, had a much smaller hydraulic load and had the wetland cells basically in parallel so that they could go through one or the other and maintain one and let the other one keep running. And consequently, they had a much greater reduction in BOD and TSS concentrations. Now I would like to give you some good news for initial installation and maintenance costs of constructed treatment wetlands. So cost considerations figure prominently into constructed wetlands popularity. The self-sustaining aspect of plant communities lower their operating costs to less than conventional treatment systems require. Their capital costs can be lower too if land is available inexpensively. Because of the way that they are constructed and the availability of inexpensive plants, constructed wetlands can also be less expensive to purchase and install than conventional systems. They are attractive in areas where land can be found at relatively low cost and in areas where clay could be conveniently transported to site to create an inexpensive liner. Alternatively, a properly sized polyethylene liner can be purchased. I expect that the cost to install one of these systems for a residence would be on the order of $15,000 to $25,000for equipment and installation, and would require biannual maintenance costs of about $500 per visit for a residence. Now, note these prices are given in 2022 prices, and they most certainly will change over time. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Please use my email address shown on this slide to make any comments or to ask questions, and I want to thank you for attending.
Thank you, Kevin, and that was fascinating. Join us next time for sodium hypochlorite generator talk with our Cyanco Fast group. Thank you, everyone.